Hello everybody and welcome to this tutorial. Here I'm just gonna continue from where I left off in the previous one. If you have not seen the previous tutorial, I strongly urge you to do so as the two are closely interrelated, so to say. Anyway, previously we've discussed some of these things such as DOS, RATS, phishing, and so on and so forth, but here I want to go a step further and tell you about SQL injections, VPNs, proxies, Tors, EPS keyloggers, and so on and so forth. You will see how all these things will play a role later on throughout the course. But for the time being, you have SQL injections, which simply passing SQL queries to HTTP requests. If they are not properly formatted by the PHP code on the server side, this can present a serious problem. And this is always one of the primary consideration of all the web developers out there. Later on I will demonstrate how you can use these, formulate them, and there is a large amount of websites that are vulnerable out there, primarily because the frameworks on which they're based are vulnerable as well. Next up, you have virtual private networks, so VPNs. These are ways of anonymizing yourselves. Basically, if you have a VPN provider somewhere, and if you want to anonymize yourself, you will route all your traffic through this VPN provider, and all the traffic between you and the VPN provider will be heavily encrypted. So any other server out there that is receiving requests from you, it is actually receiving them from VPN. There is no real way of detecting you or finding your physical location unless the VPN provider actually gives it up, which doesn't really happen if you pick a right one. Down below you have proxies. Now proxies are a less reliable way of staying anonymous, but you should always make it your common practice to use SOX 5 proxies. I will explain what these are. I will introduce them when we do proxy chains and when I explain to you how you can actually stay anonymous while conducting these sort of activities. You will realize that you can route your connection through several proxies, but very soon you will see as well that that doesn't always work. I mean, in the movies or something like that, you see people going through 10, 20 different proxies. In reality, that would be very, very difficult to implement, primarily because of internet speeds, because of the available bandwidth. Most of the free proxies out there are not very fast, and routing your connection through several of them will make it very difficult for you to do anything in a reasonable amount of time. There are of course paid proxies, but when you pay a proxy, you leave a digital footprint somewhere so you can be traced. Down below you have Tor. Now Tor is absolutely free, open source, and it is much faster than proxies. It's not faster than VPNs, but it is faster than proxies. It gives you an ability to Torify your applications, which in essence means simply routing traffic through certain routes and using certain routers on the internet to actually, not just routers, but using certain devices on the internet for your packets, for your connection to go through. It can be slow from time to time. It is not a 100% guarantee, but you will be anonymous to a very large extent if you are using Tor. There are ways of detecting you, but they are highly unlikely to happen. Like 99.99% of time, you will be almost 100% anonymous, which is a very good way of functioning. Also, you have the Tor browser, which allows you to access dark web or the hidden web, however you wish to call it. Basically, those are dot onion websites, and they are not indexed by any of the search engines out there, and they cannot be accessed via regular internet from the regular internet browsing perspective. You cannot. I mean, if you open up Firefox and if you have your internet connection, and if you don't have your internet connection configured in a proper way to connect to Tor network or something of a kind, you will not be able to access any of the hidden webs or dark webs website services, and so on and so forth. I will also show you how to access Dark Web and how to use it, as it has a vast amount of resources that are at your disposal, most of them free, some of them paid, and so on and so forth. Down below you have VPS. These are virtual private servers. It can be viewed as a security layer. For example, if you have an Apache server running on your physical machine, you can have a virtual machine within that physical machine which will serve as an SQL server for that Apache server. This is done so that the SQL server cannot be accessed from outside and that you don't have an SQL port open on your physical machine. So only devices, only programs and users from that particular machine will be able to access the virtual machine where the SQL server is. Bit of back and forth action here. It might sound unclear or something like that, but I don't want you to worry about it now. When I show you the examples, when you get into it, you will understand it. I guarantee it to you. So no problems there. Here I'm just introducing you to the terminology and giving you an idea of what is to come. Excellent. So we also have keyloggers, which are tools that are used to steal credentials, and not only credentials, but also used to extract information. If you manage to deploy a keylogger on a machine, you can configure it to record all keystrokes and then to send them to a mail address, to an FTP server. Today, keyloggers are advanced to the extent that they have like 100 options or so, configurable to the fullest of extents, and you can do pretty much whatever you want with them. I mean, they have their basic functionalities still. Basic functionalities is still there to record the keystrokes. But not only do they record keystrokes, for example, they can extract existing information as well. You can configure their behavior, how the stealth level of the keylogger, how will it hide, where will it go, where will it be installed, what sort of information do you want to extract, do you want to monitor particular folders for activity, and do you want to record it. You can configure them to take screenshots, you can configure them to use the camera on the device on which you have deployed a keylogger to take a picture every 5 minutes or something like that. That wouldn't be the brightest of ideas, because obviously somebody would see that you're taking a picture. But those are just examples of what you can do with them, and later on we will actually download a genuine keylogger, install it, deploy it. We'll show you methods of deployment and how you can configure it as well. Although you should be very careful from where you download your tools, such as keyloggers, remote administration tools, rootkits, and so on and so forth, primarily because you never, ever want to download a uncompiled binary file that is not open source, because you have no way of knowing what's in it, and you absolutely never want to run it on your computer. You might get what you want, you know, a keylogger or something of a kind, but your computer might get infected with exactly the same keylogger that you plan to deploy somewhere, or with exactly the same RAT that you intend to deploy somewhere. So that's not a very bright idea. You should use verified sources of such tools. I will show a few of them later on as I go over to the internet and download them. But I'm just making it very clear here that you should be very careful with these things. And one of the foolproof methods of doing this is actually configuring a virtual machine and doing this sort of activity on that virtual machine. So even if you get infected or something of a kind, it doesn't matter. It's a virtual machine. You can reinstall it anytime you want, very fast. Pretty much no information will be lost there. More importantly, the primary file system on your main physical machine will not be accessed from the virtual machine. Anyway, down below you have the terminal. So terminal is basically an interface for you that allows you to control your operating system. Now, Linux terminal is very powerful, we will be using it extensively. You will need to familiarize yourselves with it. I will familiarize you with it. I will teach you how to use it. To some people, it might seem a bit difficult or a bit tricky at first sight. You know, there are a lot of commands to type in, how to memorize them all, where, what to use, where, and so on and so forth. But believe me, there is a certain logic to it, and once you figure it out, everything just flies. I know by heart about 30% of possible commands out there regarding Linux terminals, and the rest I simply figure out with dash h or dash dash help. The system pretty much tells you everything you need to know. It helps you out to a great extent, and you are able to figure out a lot of things from just understanding the basic logic, how it works, and so on. Now there will always, of course, be arguments. I don't know, there'll be people saying, well, why would you use terminals? Why wouldn't you just use GUI tools or something like that? The simple answer is because they are not as nearly as powerful as the terminal tools are. Plus, terminal tools have far less dependencies, and most of the hacking tools are basically designed for the terminals. They don't have GUIs. A lot of them do have them these days, but I might go over them briefly at a certain point of time, because it is not, the GUI interfaces are not that relevant. When you figure it out how to do it on the terminal, you will automatically by default know how to do it with the graphical user interface for that particular program. Anyway, down below you have firewalls. Now, firewall in Linux is configured through IP table commands. You keep on passing arguments and configuring these firewalls. And this is one of the main reasons why you should not be using any distribution of Windows for this particular tutorial, to follow this tutorial. You will need to install you will need to install either a Linux virtual machine or create a dual boot or something of a kind. I will of course show how to do this and demonstrate it in great detail, but the firewalls are one of the main reasons why we can't use Windows for these sort of purposes. Linux firewall is open source and it has ridiculous amount of options. A ridiculous amount. I'm not kidding here. You can do with it pretty much whatever you want. You can configure, you can close open ports, forward connections via ports or via IP addresses. You can just forbid certain protocols on certain ports or forbid certain protocols for certain IP addresses, do all manner of forwarding and redirection and so on and so forth. This is all available for free with a Linux firewall, whilst in Windows you will have some of these options, but most of them you won't unless you, for example, buy a certain package or something like that, which is not something that we really want to do here. We want to keep this budget friendly, and we want to have a powerful firewall which can do pretty much whatever we want it to do. Now there'll be two ways of configuring this firewall, and if you are afraid of messing it up, don't worry about it, because most of the configurations that we will do will be short-lived configurations, so to say, primarily because all the configurations made to the firewall from iptables command, unless specified otherwise, will be temporary and they will hold until the next system reset. There is a way to circumvent this, of course, and to configure the firewall rules in the configuration file directly and thereby making the changes permanent, which is also one of the ways of doing it, but I don't generally prefer it. I prefer to have a script somewhere which you can run at any time and it will configure your firewall by default. You won't have your tool set on a USB stick or somewhere online or something of a kind, and you have these quick scripts which you generate, and then they perform these tasks for you in an automated fashion. It's really simple. I will show you how to make these scripts. You do not necessarily need some advanced programming knowledge or anything of a kind. Basically, what these scripts are a list of Linux terminal commands which we will do anyway. So basically, the script would consist out of a list of those commands, and then you just change the mod of the script to be to be an executable file, run it, and all those commands are passed to the system, and those tasks are finished in an automated fashion by default. Anyway, one of the final things that I wish to address here are reverse shells. So there are hundreds, if not thousands, of reverse shells out there that you can use. I will pick a few that we will use depending on the framework, depending on the environment, of course, that we want to infect. But in essence, what reverse shells are, as the name itself says, you have a program which you infect another device, and then that program opens up a reverse connection from that device back to you. So you can keep on passing commands, you can keep on controlling the system even though you are nowhere near it. There are different types, of course, today with routers and so on and so forth. With such firewalls, you do need to do a lot of extra configuration, and there are problems that need to be solved and addressed. You will see how, when you are trying to break into a single computer, sometimes you need to break into the router first. Usually, you need to break into the router first, unless you're performing these phishing sort of attacks, or there's a web server or something of a kind running in the background. But attacking a private device, a private computer, which is usually what people do as preludes to bigger hacks, because they want to extract some sort of information or something of a kind from, let's say, a company's employee that's a network administrator or somebody like that, they will... One of the basic vectors would be to attack a home router, change the DNS settings there, and try to steal credentials in such a way, or put the computer in the DMZ of the router, the militarized zone, so that the router is no longer effective for that device. Rather, instead, it just forwards all traffic to that device regardless. So that can be, those are just some of the types of attacks that you can do, but reverse shells will depend on the choice of the environment that you are trying to infect, and will depend on the choice of your attack route as well. In any case, I hope that you got some basic introduction to these terms. I again repeat, if you didn't figure it out all immediately, don't worry about it. We will do all of this in great details with a lot of examples, and you will understand that it's not complicated. Do not allow fear to dissuade or stop you. Just keep on going in spite of it. And if you can just stick in till the end of this course, you will, I guarantee it to you, you will understand it. With just a bit of focus and a bit of curiosity, you will be able to obtain the necessary skills needed in order to become a pen tester or an ethical hacker. I bid you all farewell, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.